Now it's spastic paraparesis, and again it's very commonly appearing in the Paces exam, and the command is examine the lower limbs, okay, because as the name indicates, it's a spastic paraparesis. So now there are multiple causes for the spastic paraparesis. Now what is important, like if you get a command examine the lower limb, okay, you did your examination and you found that there is spastic paraparesis, but what is important, as I always emphasize, that you should spare 1 minute after finishing your examination to do the relevant. So in this case, that 1 minute is very precious, and that relevant you will do, and then you can come to the cause, or you can come to the diagnosis, what is cause for spastic paraparesis. Otherwise, if you get a command examine the lower limb and you do lower limb examination within required time, okay, you will get good marks, but in this case you will not be able to make your diagnosis. You will give a list of differentials, like there are multiple causes for spastic paraparesis, that you will tell, but if you will do the relevant, then you will know the cause, you will know the diagnosis, you can reach to the exact diagnosis. Okay, so now spastic paraparesis, what is spastic paraparesis? It is pyramidal weakness, like upper motor neuron type of weakness, and if it is long standing, and then there can be wasting contracture, and there will all be upper motor neuron weakness type of signs, like hypertonia, hyperreflexia, ankle clonus and extensor plantar. Okay, so now you will present like this. On examination of this gentleman, I found that he is having wasting, there are contractures, and he is having pyramidal weakness as evidenced by hypertonia, hyperreflexia, ankle clonus and extensor plantar response. And if it is due to cord compression, then on the examination of the sensory system, I found that sensation is impaired in the lower limb with a sensory level at the level of T9, T10, whatever level you got. There is no deformity, no tenderness, and no dressing, but there is a surgical scar over the thoracic spine. If it is dressing, you can mention. If there is no dressing, you don't mention. And if you examine the gait, you will tell that on examination of the gait, patient has scissoring gait, and also you can get high steppage gait, both is possible. So on the basis of this, my diagnosis is patient is having spastic paraparesis with sensory level at T9 or T10, and most likely causes cord compression. Okay, so like this you will present. Now whatever the cause you get, whatever the signs you get, then you will describe according to that. I gave you only one example. Okay, now I will tell you. Now if the command is examine lower limb, and you examine lower limb and you found spastic paraparesis, okay, now here in spastic paraparesis, this spastic paraparesis you found in the motor system, while our list of differential or our diagnosis, it will be decided on the basis of sensory system. Okay, on that is very important in this case. On the basis of sensory system, we will decide what the patient is having. Like on the motor system, you found that patient is having spastic paraparesis. Now you check the sensation, and patient sensation is impaired, and you got the sensory level. Like T9, T10, whatever your patient has. So it means patient is having cord compression. Okay, it could be due to tumor, abscess, any trauma, any wound like this. So you got sensory level with spastic paraparesis. Now what relevant you will do? You will examine the back and ask patient to walk. Okay. So one thing I want to tell you that. Okay, I will tell you then about the gait of spastic paraparesis. Now you examine the patient and you found that sensory system is intact, like there is no problem with the sensation. Okay, so what differential should come into your mind? You should think of motor neuron disease or anterior horn cell disease, again head it is spastic, paraparesis, sagittal tumor and multiple sclerosis. Okay, please keep these all four differentials in your mind. If you found that there is no impairment of sensation, what relevant you will do for individually, I told you in every case which I explained you, but here mainly briefly I will explain that if no impairment of sensation, what relevant you will do, you will examine the upper limb for fasciculations, for wasting, and examine the tongue again for fasciculation. This is we are doing for motor neuron disease or anterior horn cell disease, and you can check the cerebellar signs for multiple sclerosis. Okay, now if you found on the sensory system that there is impairment of pain and temperature, then two diagnoses should come to your mind: syringomyelia and anterior spinal artery occlusion. Okay, and for anterior spinal artery occlusion, what relevant you will do, you will check the pulse, radial pulse. And in the syringomyelia, again I will explain you individually when I will come to that case, but briefly you can check the upper limb for the wasting, for the fasciculations, for the scars, for the Charcot's joint. Okay, so like this. And if you found that there is involvement of dorsal column, okay, dorsal column sensation is impaired. What are dorsal column sensations? Dorsal column or posterior column vibration and proprioception. Okay, if you found that these two are impaired, then there is mnemonic MAST, M-A-S-T. In MAST there is double M and double T. It should come into your mind and I will tell you what it what it signifies. It is cervical myelopathy, from 1M myelopathy, 2M multiple sclerosis, from A Friedreich ataxia, S Sacred, T Tebopiresis and T tropical spastic paraparesis. Okay, so then if you found this, then what relevant you need to do, again examine the upper limb for the wasting and for the cerebellar signs, and for the cerebellar signs for the Friedreich ataxia and for the multiple sclerosis. Okay, and wasting again for these causes, different which are wasting of hand like cervical myelopathy, Friedreich ataxia, multiple sclerosis, and you can examine the eyes and tongue for second. So at least this you can do the relevant. And one thing, it is its sub variety of dorsal column impairment. If you found that there is dorsal column impairment, and now two things you need to see: whether there are absent ankle jerk and extensor plantar. Like you will find extensor plantar as a part of pyramidal weakness in all causes for spastic paraparesis, and also you will find hyperreflexia. But if you found that ankle jerk is absent, then two causes should come into your mind: Sacket and tebopiresis. Okay, so for that, what relevant you will do, you will examine the eyes for anemia and examine the tongue, and then you can ask the patient to walk, you can examine the gait. And also you can find one differential you should keep into your mind: peripheral neuropathy and stroke. Okay, like this case, absent ankle and extensor plantar. So this is one of the cause. And you can ask also patient, can you walk for me for a few steps? But the gait in the spastic paraparesis is not much diagnostic, it's not much high yield, because candidates cannot appreciate the gait and they get confused. So you can perform the gait, but better if you do other relevants which I explained now with every disease, which are high yield and very much diagnostic. If they will be impaired, you will know immediately. And in the spastic paraparesis, what gait you can get, there will be scissoring gait. Okay, now I cannot explain you on audio SMS how the scissoring gait is. I can perform if you are with me, I can perform in front of you. And they can be high steppage gait because of and foot drop, because of upper motor neuron weakness, but again because of spasticity it will not be clear. Okay, so like this you have to explain the spastic paraparesis if you get in your exam, okay, and how you will diagnose. Again, diagnosis will depend upon the cause whatever you get in the exam, and individual investigations for every case I explained you when I explained every case, and then you can fit into that. Like if you get multiple sclerosis, you think that there are cerebellar signs, it could be Friedreich ataxia or multiple sclerosis, then you will explain the investigations of multiple sclerosis and Friedreich ataxia. If you found that there, if you think that there is sensory level and there is cord compression, then you will think for MRI, X-ray, like this. And if you think that there is no sensory impairment and patient is could have motor neuron disease or anterior horn cell disease, then you can tell that diagnosis is clinical. So like this you have to fit on, whatever case you get in your exam, you have to fit on your investigations. And how you will manage, again as always we manage, my management is general and specific. General is same as always I am explaining, and specific includes medical and surgical. So medical, if examiner asks, you can say that we can give oral and intrathecal pharmacotherapy, we can give baclofen, okay, and or baclofen pump. So and if surgical, then I think you don't need to remember the names of procedure, this is enough. So I hope I explained all the causes for the spastic paraparesis, and it will not be difficult for you. If any confusion, then you can put the question, I will reply according to that.
Please like, share and subscribe my YouTube channel for more videos. Thank you.